Hi friends, Chandrasekhar here again, and now we are into the 10th lecture in the series of lectures on Jaimini Sutra or Upadesha Sutra, as you like it, I mean as you like to call it. Now we will go to the next sutra, that is, by sutra I don't mean one single sutra, I mean a group of sutras, a thread. We saw what happens when Ketu is in Karakausha and aspected by various planets or connected with various planets and so on in the last lecture, the 9th lecture, if I remember right. It is the 9th lecture. And here, what we are going to do is, we shall look at something which always interests everybody. And you will also find that sometimes the sutras come in a certain order and sometimes there is a sudden change, you know, from the 10th house to 4th house or 4th house to 7th house. And so it is quite possible that since they were all memorized by the disciples of the sages, there could be something which is not in exactly the order that the sage told him or them. When I say him, that means the disciple, direct disciple, and when I say them, then the disciple's disciple and so on, because it took long time for people to get into the habit of manuscript, writing down everything, as their perhaps memory became weak as mine has become with age. So then the actually writing started, which was perhaps passed on from one to other to another, and there can always, memory always plays tricks with you, especially when you are advanced in age, and these sciences took years to master them. So we saw what happens when Ketu occupies the Karakausha and some other planet aspect. So again, here my original theory that I have been talking about in all my lectures, and especially in the first ones, is that there are to be three things to come together for something to happen. So here it has to be in Karakausha, X planet, somebody else has to aspect it. So first is being in Karakausha, another is a particular planet, and the third parameter comes when it aspects. So remember all this when you try to apply Jaimini principles, because it becomes so easy to remember the sutra and forget what was the earlier one, where from that thread has come. Now here it starts with Riffa Buddha Buddha Drushte Mandavata. Riffa, I mean you can make out yourself, you know, for your, so 2 is 22, reverse, it will again be 22, divided by 12, what you get is 10, so this is about the 10th bhava. When Buddha occupies the 10th bhava, from where? Obviously from the Karakamsha, because earlier sutras were about Karakamsha. Keto Karakamsha, so it is Karakamsha or Sansha, whichever we will look at it. I will try to perhaps give something, some small piece in of 4 or 5 points where from we can see all these things as told by sages. I will try that to introduce it into the video. I am not sure whether my skills will permit me to do it, but I hope to do it. And so which will make it unnecessary perhaps for me to go on repeating the same thing again and again. I many a times think I tell that twice or thrice. Of course it is good for memorizing it, but then maybe you will be getting bored, so I will give it in one of the lectures, perhaps this one. So what he is saying is, if Buddha, Mercury, occupies the 10th from Karakausha, or Buddha happens to aspect the 10th from Karakausha. Now what aspect? The great sage has already talked about only the Rashi Drushti. He has not talked about Graha Drushti here. So this is influence of a particular place on the 10th bhava. Because in Jaimini, as you know, the Rashi's aspect. So when Rashi's aspect, that means influence of one Rashi on another, the Chara on the Sthira or Ubhaya on Ubhaya, as we have already seen how those aspects are there, and whatever planet occupies it. So at X or Y distance, it will be not very difficult to understand. You know that 3, 5, 9 and 6, 8 and 11, that is how it goes about. So it's not very difficult to understand how those, individual Rashi, depending on its nature, Chara, Sthira or Ubhaya, have different way of looking at other Rashis. And so, and vice versa, of course. So if Buddha is aspecting the 10th house also will be aspecting the Rashi which houses Buddha. isn't it? Or it will be in 10th house itself, it will again be aspecting the Rashi from which it could have aspected the 10th house. The 10th bhava. From where? From Karakamsha. It can also be seen from Lagna and others, as I will be trying to put a brief note sort of thing if I can in my VSDC free editing software. So if I cannot, please excuse me. I will try to do it some other way, in some other lecture perhaps. So what he says? Rifve Budhe Buddha Drushte Mandavata. As the same thing he will be doing as is done by Manda. Manda is Saturn. He says na grahaha. So grahas are to be read as graha. Don't try to, you know, some people might have done it to, you know, interpret Manda in the Katapayadi manner, but that would be wrong. The sage has already told him where not to use it. So we remember earlier there was a sutra called Prasiddha Karma Jivaha. So now Karma Jiva is one who earns by his own efforts. So when Shani is there, so what he does is Saturn, obviously again connected with Rifa because Mandavata is said, so that will also come somewhere ahead, or he may not even mention it in the next sutras. That person will be doing something for which his family is known for. He is one of the interpretations. So people say he will do the same thing which was done by his family or ancestors and will be very famous for that. It could also mean that he would be famous for putting in a lot of efforts in achieving whatever enterprise or career he undertakes, because Saturn, remember, is a very hard worker. Buddha himself is a trader. He is also somebody who can grasp things very easily. So with this you will have to understand why Buddha and Saturn, so both are able to do things beyond imagination. Both have got the understanding. The difference is that Buddha does it instinctively. He will do whatever is taught to him by Guru, because he is supposed to be in the Puranas, he is said to be the disciple of Guru. Isn't it? So he will do whatever has been told to him. And here also Shani also represents the ancients, the occult, the earlier generations. So both of them will have similar results. The exact nature would naturally change, which I think will come later on in the sutras. And so this is what happens when Buddha, Mercury, occupies or aspects the 10th bhava from the Karakamsha. Next sutra is, it will also tell you why sutras are difficult to interpret and why a person with limited intelligence like me doesn't generally use them, though I remember most of them. But not certain necessarily in the same order, and that is why I am always careful. So the next sutra is Shubha Drushte Sthayah. If such a Buddha, such a Mercury occupying or aspecting the 10th bhava is aspected by a benefic, then he says Sthayah. Now Sthayah has been interpreted by most of the Jaimini commentators, the great commentators, the ancient one as well as the modern ones, as that this means he is sthira, means sthira, he is after a work that he has undertaken, and he will be very well known, a great person, he would succeed like anything. And there is, but then what is sthira in Sanskrit? You have to understand that there are many meanings. One of the meanings is sthayo vivadasya Nirnayitari Purohite Iti. So who is there? He is somebody who gives judgment about any dispute, and also one who is a Purohita, the performer of, you know, different rituals, religious rituals. That person is known as Sthaya. This is the definition. This is one of the way Sthaya is interpreted. And who will be Shubha Drushta? Now Buddha himself is a Shubha Graha, but he will be aspected, or place occupied by him will be aspected. So what is left is, and moon is sometimes benefic, sometimes not. What is left is Jupiter and Venus, obviously. And both of them are called guru of the either the devas or the daityas. Both are purohitas. Both are those who can impart knowledge, both of them who know ritual well. Both of them are also supposed to be great astrologers. So this could also be one of the meaning. And then it could also mean he would be somebody who would be a judge in the modern terminology, or somebody who is a consultant, or rather who is considered by the disputing party. So maybe a sort of arbitrator, that is also possible. He could also be a businessman, because even business, the same thing is there. Customer wants it at a lesser rate and he wants to sell at a higher rate, or rather his principals want him to sell at a higher rate and he has to decide what is to be done. So both the things are possible. Whereas another interpretation is, there is a Vruddha Karika. Vruddha is the learned people. And they have given something. So Karakamsha Chan Dashame Shubhaketa Nirikshite. In Karakamsha, the tense from Karakamsha, if aspected by Shubhaketa, that is benefic. Now here does not necessarily mean aspect of Buddha. According to the Karika, so we will have to think that even if it Buddha is not there, if benefics are aspect, this will happen. What will happen? Sthira Chitto Bhavet Balo. The person, the one born, Bala is the young one. Jata also means the young one. So that Jataka means one who is born. So Balo is Sthira Chitto Bhavet Balo Gambhira Bahuviryavan. He is deep. Deep means Gambhir is a complex word to explain anyway, but I'll try. Gambhir also means somebody who is mature, who understands depth of things. And Bahuviryavan, he will be very valorous. This is what is the result of Karakamsha, the tenth from the Karakamsha being aspected by a benefic. So this is also one of the meanings of the sthaya. So it would depend. So most of the learned interpreters have opted for this meaning, and many of them think that this is connected with Buddha being in the tenth house. So it is not in isolation. This is one of the interpretation. It could also be different, but I think this is right, because as we go to the next lecture and we approach the next the sutras, then we will see he will now be going to the fourth from Karakamsha and so on. So this sutra is limited here. Connected with the earlier ones, well, that we have seen in earlier lecture, Prasiddha Karma Jiva and so on and so forth. So there he has given different work that a person will be doing. That is when it has to connect with Karakamsha. And here it is when it has to do with the tenth from the Karakamsha. So what this means could be, these are interconnected, the tenth house and the lagna, or 10th from Karakamsha and Karakamsha, both are capable of delivering or indicating the profession that a person can undertake. And I will not exactly be opposed to this theory, because I also many a time see, especially when a person is in a business or something which is very well, a work which is very able, then planets aspecting the 7th bhava can also indicate the precise area where he would be working, especially if he is on his own, that he is in a business or something like that. So this is how all these things go. Then the next sutra comes. Before I close, I will close with the next sutra, which is Ravo Guru Matra Drushte Gopalaha. Now here, since Ravo is said, the Buddha is gone. That thread is over. Shubhadrushte Steya, Riffe Buddha, Buddha Drushte, Mandavata, then Shubhadrushte Steya. This thread is over. We have also interpreted what the Steya means. We have seen both the meanings of Steya. This is just so that you people understand that there are different ways of interpreting the sutra. That is why I am giving you those karikas, or sometimes even something which is said by the great Parashara I will be talking about. I would generally restrict myself to karikas and other interpretations. Because You already have read the Brihat Parashara Hora Shastra, so I think you don't need to know what is written there. You will be reading them anyway. So the next one is Ravo. So Ravi is sun. If he is placed in the Karakausha, I would also say, looking to the earlier sutra of Rife Buddha Guru Drushte, Buddha Buddha Drushte, so whether occupying or aspecting the 10th from Karakausha, because see, aspect is an influence, so that influence ultimately is anyway on the 10th Bhava and Guru Matra Drushte, if it is aspected only by Jupiter, then the person becomes a dairy person, rearer of animal. This is Gopala. Gopala is one who rears cattle. Now cattle has to be taken into a larger canvas, I can say. So it can be buffalo, it can be anything to do with cattle, it could also be anything to do with whatever machinery. Maybe even the food processing machinery, because ultimately what cattle does, it eats something and processes it and turns out something else for you. Especially for Indians, it is always milk which is to be consumed by a person. And Guru is also connected with eating. If you remember, I think I have said somewhere that if Jupiter aspects the Lagna or the second, that person loves to eat. He is a foodie, if I may say that. So he may eat too much, or he might be a connoisseur of food. So here, when Sun, the administrator, has influence on the 10th from the Karakausha, and if he is aspected by Jupiter, can give the capacity or administrative capacity to administer huge number of cattle, because well, anybody who has had a dairy or had some experience of rearing of large herds of cattle know it is difficult to manage them. You need skills to manage them. All animals have different personalities, and then they have different needs, or what makes them work would be different from animal to animal. Same thing will happen even if you are in the food processing industry, because you will have a large number of stuff which has to be managed, and the end product, which is milk, also varies from day to day. The quality of milk also will vary from day to day. Same will happen in a food processing plant. I mean, you may think, and that is why people nowadays generally tend to add artificial additives and stabilizers and everything there, so as to be able to give you a standard test. But as you can see, those who out of you will be knowing more about either milk or even wine. Every year the test changes. Why? Because this is changeable. So perhaps this Ravo Guru Matra Drushte is talking about something to be eaten and ability to administer all those things, all those different factors which can arise in rearing animals or food processing industry or any industry or any matter, even teaching, I would say, because Guru also is connected with teaching or imparting knowledge. He would have to handle many type of disciples or students who have different different motives or I would say different incentives make them work, and that administrator has to find out what makes one work. That is how kings also rule. So Ravi is king, don't forget that. So this is how I would interpret this sutra, though it calls only about a person being rearer of animals. In modern times there would be few who will be rearing animals, and we have to understand that across countries and across cultures, different animals can be reared. I mean, somebody would be, say, in Australia would be rearing sheep, probably not cattle, not necessarily cattle. So Gopala has to be taken in a larger perspective, and He could also be a large farmer, because somewhere else he talks about being Karshaka. Karshaka is the farmer. Krushi, Karshaka. One who does Krushi. Krushi is agriculture. One who whose business is agriculture, or who undertakes agriculture. A farmer is also indicated by Guru. You will find in one of the sutras. Perhaps earlier we might have talked about it, or we will be talking about it later on. So, my dear friends, it was already 20 minutes and I am exceeding my self-imposed time limit, and I take your leave. Do let me know whether you are liking these lectures, because I take 2 or 3 or 4 sutras at a time, sometimes of course 12, as I did in I think the first sutra, where I went through all the 12 rashis. But I want you to understand that it is really difficult for even the great commentators to exactly interpret what Jaimini means, and we have in the modern times to modify what is being said and try to understand the reason behind it, so that we will not fail when we use the Jaimini principles in real life, on real life charts. So my friends, I take your leave and good night. Thank you very much.